Dr. Winrow, you brought up that we have the biblical founding, and we're going to shift gears to a theological question, and that is, what should we be preaching and teaching at this particular time? And I am thrilled that we have the director of ministry outreach at Pepperdine University, my good friend Mike Cope, who also directs the Harbor Bible Lectures, which we missed this year, but Lord willing, we'll get next year. And Mike is going to talk a little bit about preaching from the prison epistles. But Mike, I got to have you say a word. I understand you and N.T. Wright are having a spot of breakfast tomorrow morning that folks may be able to join in on. Mike, tell us about that.
I think it'll be breakfast for us, and it'll be dinner for Tom since he'll be over in England. You'll see the invitation come in the chat area here. You're welcome to join us. We have over 250 registered, but there are a few more. Tom agreed to meet with ministers from Churches of Christ briefly tomorrow. It'll be 8 o'clock West Coast time, and he's going to talk primarily about the book just being released, God and the Pandemic. But I've asked Tom to speak briefly to this issue of especially how Paul's thinking speaks to this issue of racial injustice. And it's geared toward ministers of Churches of Christ. I think Tom's going to take a moment at the end to bless our people. And I look forward to that. Thank you, Jeff. And that's a good place for me to begin because there's a reason so many of us have felt indebted to Tom Wright, and that is that he has a high ecclesiology, just like people from the Restoration Movement have. We were taught to believe that the church is vital, that it's important, and central to the teaching of N.T. Wright is that the church is prominent in the plan of God. Now, another important thing is that Tom leads what's been called the new perspective on Paul. The old perspective on Paul is what many people fell into because of Martin Luther. Martin Luther felt guilty all the time because of Catholic indulgences and so on. And so he projected that back to Paul and said, Paul's main issue is the question of whether I'm saved by faith or works. And the new perspective on Paul says, that wasn't Paul's deal. That was Martin Luther's deal. Now, it's true that some of us have those issues, and Paul does speak to that, but Paul's central focus was that he was an apostle to the Gentiles. So Paul's central issue is, how does God bring together Jew and Gentile, male and female, slave and free? How does he bring all of his creation together for the ultimate new heaven and new earth restoration? Paul's trying to figure that out. How do you have communities of faith built up of people who come from different areas? How has God made us all one in Christ while still being faithful to the promises to Israel? That's the brilliance of the new perspective on Paul, and many of us were introduced to it through Tom Wright. So one of the things Tom has always said is we would probably be healthier if we began reading Paul through Ephesians or Colossians instead of Romans or Galatians. Because we tend to come in as lawyers when we come through Romans or Galatians, and we pull out Martin Luther and we obsess over whether works matter or don't matter. And he said, when you go to the prison epistles, you find out that Paul's scope of salvation is much larger, that God is bringing all things together in the resurrected Christ. And a signpost of that is the people of God. So racism makes no sense in the people of God. It's opposed to our calling because we are a little signpost of what God will one day do to all of God's creation. But he started here with the people of the Messiah filled with the Holy Spirit. So this little study of the prison epistles began a few months ago. Some young ministers got together and decided in light of quarantine, shelter in place, they needed to drop their preaching plans. And so one of them came up with the idea, let's preach on the prison epistles because Paul was sheltering in place. I'm like, okay. So they asked if I would teach them every week to prepare them quickly to preach from those epistles, which we did, having no idea of the social unrest that was about to come And what we have learned is that these prison epistles speak so powerfully to what's taking place, and that's the focus I want to have here. So, Duane and Fate, thank you, dear brothers, for what you said. I see my dear friend Jerry Taylor has joined us, and so many others who've been our teachers and guides. And boy, what you two shared is sobering, and I hope that in some ways this builds on that. So let me see if I can successfully share some notes here. Is that up, Jeff? Are we good? Let's start with the book of Ephesians. I'm going to do Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians very briefly, and a little more time in Philemon. Our time is limited, and I'll honor the time. And all I want to do is make the case that these prison epistles speak right into the heart of what we are facing. Ephesians is this overarching picture of reconciliation and peace. Paul alludes to the gospel of peace at the end of chapter 6. You don't get his normal faith, hope, and love. You get faith, peace, and love. And there is a disproportionate use of the word peace in the book of Ephesians, or echoing the old Hebrew phrase, word shalom, that God's wholeness is coming, God's making all things right. And I like these words by Michael Gorman, one of my favorite New Testament scholars. He said, the church is or should be a sign of hope in the fractured world. It can be the bridge between enemies, between the realities of this broken age and those of the coming age of shalom, and between the hatred and violence in our own hearts and in the hearts of others. I'm telling you, Paul is not trying to agonize over his guilt. He knows that he has been saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. What he's trying to do is build a people of unity that are a sign and symbol of the coming shalom of God, that they are embedded right here and right now. Most of us are familiar with the way many of Paul's books are outlined, that you have Paul's indicative, his theological statements, and then often the transition word therefore, and then a description of the kind of life we are to live. And because we tend to be moralists, we like to jump to the end. But it's in these early theological statements that you find something majestic is happening. And particularly in Ephesians, he says that God is seeking to bring all things in heaven and on earth together under one head, even Christ. Now, one picture of salvation could be Romans 3, talking about the atonement. But the larger picture that the atonement is a subcategory of is God is reconciling, restoring, mending all things. That's the great mystery in the book of Ephesians, because that involves the bringing together of disparate groups. And so when you get to chapter 2, the part we're more familiar with, because this is more like Martin Luther stuff, is the first half, that salvation is by grace through faith, and we become the handiwork of God. And of course, in Churches of Christ, we made sure you knew that that includes baptism. And of course, in Paul, it always does include baptism. But the real point of Ephesians may be that having established that God has done that, the new work of God is seen in the church. So the last half of chapter 2, the wall that divides us has come down through the resurrected Christ. We become, what Tom Wright says, a small working model of God's new creation. I love Robert Frost's old poem, "Something There Is That Doesn't Love a Wall That Wants It Down." And you can see that in the language of Ephesians, that with God, there is something, someone who doesn't love a wall. He wants it down. And just as we saw, many of us saw images in 1989 of the Berlin Wall coming down, Paul says, in the gospel of Christ, these divisions fall apart, and we catch a glimpse of the glory of all things being reconciled and all people being united in Christ. And I'm sorry, I'm sprinting here. We're now in Philippians. We're going to do the first three pretty quickly. But in Philippians, again, an important issue for the issue of reconciliation and racial injustice and white privilege. in Philippians, at the end, you find out Paul is trying to reconcile two women who are leaders in the church, Euodia and Syntyche. But because Paul believes how you do something is maybe as important as what you wind up saying, much of Philippians is getting us there. Typically, we turn Philippians into just little memes. I like this one, I can do all things through a Bible verse taken out of context. So we're familiar with Philippians 4:13 and rejoice in the Lord always and so on. But there's something deep here. What's Philippians about? Well, Paul says in chapter 1 and verse 27, it's about how they live. And many of you know that twice in the book, he uses the Greek word that we get politics from, politeuma, that we live the life of somebody who is in the kingdom of God. I am not primarily an American. That's where I live, and secondarily, yes, by location. But primarily, my citizenship is in the kingdom of God and my deepest allegiance, the one to whom I pledge allegiance. Ultimate allegiance is the risen Christ. So what's it about? It's about how we live. But the brilliance of Paul is that he knows behind how we live, there's a certain way of seeing reality, a certain way of thinking. And so the Greek word phronein, which has to do with how we think, how we, the Christian mindset, appears again and again in Philippians. And by the way, for I should have mentioned this earlier, I'll make these slides available to you. But again, Paul's brilliance, beneath the phronein, beneath the way we think, the kingdom mindset is embedded in a story. It's a story that's lived out in people like Epaphroditus and Timothy in chapter 2, models of people who lay down their lives for others. But Epaphroditus and Timothy are no different than Paul, who uses himself in chapter 1 and chapter 3 as somebody who's found a greater cause. In fact, he doesn't care what's done to him by the false teachers as long as Christ is preached. And then one more time, the deepest brilliance of Paul is that beneath all of this is what Michael Gorman calls the master story of the Apostle Paul, which is chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. The story of Christ who humbles himself, becomes obedient to death, even death on a cross. That's the story by which all of Philippians is built. It's the story echoed in Paul and Epaphroditus and Timothy. And he hopes will be modeled by Euodia and Syntyche. And Paul's word to us in Philippians would be that the church needs to get about finding the model of Christ. We follow one who did not ride into Washington, D.C. on the back of a white steed. He went into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, and he was crucified and was raised on the third day. Our defining master story is a story that has no other option than reconciliation. Mm-hmm. Colossians. Mike Cope doing Colossians in 3 minutes. So Colossians is this lovely book where you find out in chapter 2 that there's a problem, that some people followed Paul in that tiny little community of Colossae and said, you know, we like Paul's gospel, but he does not tell you how to grow. And like a lot of religious people, they've got a way to grow. You need to do more and think more and feel more. And chapter 2 is full of all of their methods of getting people shaped up. But I think the great insight of Colossians is chapter 2 and 19. Paul said, these people have lost connection with the head from whom the whole body, supported and held together by its ligaments and sinews, grows as God causes it to grow. There's a kind of growth that is steroidal. It may work. In fact, churches may pat themselves on the back. Look, we're getting bigger. We're growing. But Paul is most impressed with the kind of growth God gives, which is the growth that says that Jesus is enough. Enough to save us, enough to mature us. And therefore, the last two chapters, there is a life that is worthy of God's calling in Christ. Mm-hmm. And in the midst of that, listen to what he says. This is, oh, that's Philippians. Colossians chapter 3, He says, here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Now, here's the funny little thing. Because you find out at the end that Tychicus and Onesimus are the two who took the letter. There's a lot said about Tychicus, but there was some awkwardness about the fact that Onesimus took the letter of Colossians. And that is because he actually took two letters. And we find out who Onesimus was. And as the church at Colossae received these letters, everybody's holding their breath, not because of theology of Colossae, of Colossians, but because of the return of Onesimus. And so now finally, the book of Philemon. Jeff, four or five more minutes. Is that okay? I'll do
Go
this
for it.
Quickly.
Go for it,
okay.
Mike.
Philemon, which if I were giving it a title, I would call the conversion of Philemon. Now, I know we want to call it the conversion of Onesimus, but we're not exactly sure what happened to Onesimus. But what we do know is that Paul's looking for the conversion of Philemon. Philemon is already a brother. He's a leader of the church in Colossae. But even leaders of religious communities need deeper conversions. And that's what's happening to many of us at this time. I've been listening. I've been trying to let people like Fate teach me. I need to be converted further. I need to go deeper into the way of Jesus Christ. So what happened? Well, either Onesimus was a runaway slave who'd wronged Philemon and comes into contact with Paul and is converted, or Philemon was a slave who wronged Philemon and is now gone to find somebody he knows Philemon trusts. We're not sure which it is. Traditionally, we think of the first one, but probably, again, it begs the question of where Paul was when he wrote the prison letters. I tend to think he's in Ephesus. It's so much easier to explain Paul going back and forth from Colossae to Ephesus than it is Rome, but that part doesn't really matter. But in Colossians, here's what happens. Paul is trying to bring together the slave owner and this, I suppose, runaway slave. And he's going to do it in a way that is gospeled. So the first thing he does in Philemon is he grabs a hold of Philemon and he affirms him. He speaks constantly about things he knows about Philemon. I thank my God as I remember you in my prayers because I hear about your love for all his holy people and your prayer in the Lord Jesus. I pray that your koinonia, your partnership with us in the faith, may be effective in deepening your understanding of every good thing we share in the sake of Christ. Your love has given me great joy and encouragement because you, brother, have refreshed the hearts of God's people. So Paul reaches out and affirms Philemon, even though Philemon's got stuff to learn. And then he reaches over and he speaks about Onesimus. And he begins affirming Onesimus, who is now a brother, beloved. Paul trusts him. Paul needs him. And then what he does, beginning in verse 17, with his hand on each of them, is to say, and now I need you to come back together. And Philemon, I expect you to receive him, not as a slave, but as a brother. And then there's some greetings at the end. That's such a reduction of this great book. I might mention, some of you know, Tom Wright, a year or two ago, came out with 1,600 pages in these two volumes. And as he writes about Paul and the faithfulness of God, guess where he begins? The book of Philemon, because Tom thinks that embedded in this little book is a portrayal of how Paul understands the gospel, because you cannot have a gospel without reconciliation and social implications. Now, quickly, a touchy subject. Paul never demands that Christian slave owners release their slaves. He tries to transform the master-slave relationship. I think most of us know Paul. This was not a democracy. Paul didn't have the power to do that. And he's working within the church. And we can point out that slavery then was not what slavery was in 19th century America. But having said that, it's still, I know to many, a disturbing thing. Of course. Some think Paul accepted slavery, just trying to transform relationships of those who were Christians. Some think Paul didn't approve, but chose not to fight it in light of other priorities, namely the church's mission effort. Others think he didn't try to eliminate slavery because he thought the Lord would return soon. But many notice that Paul included principles that would eventually undermine slavery, just like he had said in that other letter, Colossians, the people in Colossae got, where he said, these things will fall, or like Galatians chapter 3. I love this quote by Sarah Rudin in her book, Paul Among the People. She says, Paul turns his sermonizing into a bomb, presses down the detonator and walks away, leaving glittering fragments of absurdity in place of the conviction that people solve problems. This could be called a cop-out, a pie in the sky, but in the most practical terms, he was justified. The early Christian church, without staging any actual campaign against slavery in the course of the centuries, weakened it until it all but disappeared from Europe. Slavery was doomed simply because it jarred with Christian feeling, the same basic circumstance that doomed it in the modern West. So here's why Paul argues this, and why you have to understand how Paul gets to what Paul wants. Number one, he wants us to have a new way to see people. He doesn't just make the request. It matters to him how you do it. You've got to see Onesimus in another way. You've got to see these people as made in the image of God, full bearers of the image of God, and now as believers, fellow believers. Second, the mark of faith to Paul is always cruciform love. He says in Philemon, I could argue based on duty. Duty's not a bad thing, but duty falls away. I'm arguing on the basis of love. And in some ways, it's like the old principle, give a man a fish and he has one meal, teach him to fish, and now he has many meals. You could require it, but another way is to teach him to think in a new way. And the third thing is that this is a result of God's reconciliation, koinonia, that orthodoxy, right thinking's got to be matched by orthopraxy. And to Paul, in Christ, we belong to one another. It's sobering to me to hear Dwayne and Faith say, I think Dwayne said that our racial divisions are greater in our churches than before the civil rights movement. That just makes me gasp and think. And I don't even know what to say other than I'm listening, and we all have our work to be cut out before us. But I want us to know the gospel is enough. The gospel has the resources. It's got the conviction, and that this new perspective on Paul is right. That the gospel is not just about me individually making sure I'm saved and then living any way I want. The gospel is about reconciliation. The gospel is about God bringing all things together in Christ. And a sign of that is this little beachhead of the kingdom known as the people of God. Mm-hmm. And so I commend to you the prison epistles and what they serve as a resource for us during this important time.
Wow. Mike, are there some things that you've written that you had shared with those young ministers you mentioned about that you'd be willing to share, or are you just pointing people towards some other resources?
No, we kind of did this on the fly. So I don't yet have any resources available, okay. but I take that as a challenge to work on.
There you go, yeah. I mean, of course, Tom Wright can turn out a book in what, a month or two?
Yeah, he puts an essay in Time, they ask for a book, and it's there 2 weeks later. You know?
Exactly. Well, Mike, that was amazing. This is all recorded so that guys and gals, you can go back and re-listen to it, as I will want to catch all those good things. And I think there may be a lot of preaching from the prison epistles over the coming months in our churches. Let me again say, tomorrow morning, 8 o'clock, Conversation with Tom Wright on God and the Pandemic. And is this a new book as well, Mike?
Yeah, the book just came out. He's got several new books coming out, but this is his newest one, God and the Pandemic. And he's going to speak about racial reconciliation, and then he's going to speak about God and the Pandemic, and then he's going to bless ministers from Churches of Christ. Wow. All of you are invited. Just click on the link to register.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Mike. God bless you, and we look forward to all of us being able to be together at Harbor again, Lord willing, next year. Do we have a date for that just yet, Mike, or no?
We do not.
Okay. But
we do not. Stay tuned. We're all staying tuned.
All right. Thanks much, brother. God bless.